Hello, everyone, and welcome to the launch of the Haleh Esfandiari Forum featuring our keynote speaker, Secretary Madeleine Albright. I'm Henri Barkey. I'm the director of the Middle East program at the Wilson Center, and I'm delighted to be honoring my friend and my predecessor, Haleh Esfandiari. She's there, okay. For a moment, I wasn't sure. Who founded the Middle East program in 1988 and led it admirably until June 2015. Thank you, Haleh, for your leadership, for your vision. Most of you know Haleh well, and you know what kind of extraordinary woman she is and how much she has done for women's empowerment in the region. And I would like for a moment to recognize her. And for good measure, by the way, there are copies of her extensive bio on the outside table. I'm also delighted to welcome Secretary Albright, who was actually my boss many years ago, and an excellent one, if I may say so, as the first keynote speaker of the Haleh Esfandiari Forum. Thank you so much for joining us and for offering some insightful remarks on today's launch event. Following Secretary Albright's remarks, Jane Harman, the director, president, and CEO of the Wilson Center, will moderate a conversation with Secretary Albright before moving to questions from the audience. Thank you, Jane, for being with us to launch this forum. All three of these women, Haleh, Madeleine, and Jane, have remarkable careers and are resolute leaders in their fields. Some of the goals for this forum are to highlight women like these who have made significant impact and to promote women's empowerment in the Middle East and North Africa. And here I would like to recognize the Global Women's Leadership Initiative led by Gwen Young, my colleague, who is also sponsoring the forum and today's launch event. The Middle East Program and the Global Women's Leadership Initiative established the Haleh Esfandiari Forum this year, thanks to the generous contribution of the Safari Foundation USA, including its president, Lara Alame, who's joining us today. The Educational Ventures Incorporation, Inc., of Mr. and Mrs. Lynn Johnson, the Hand Foundation of Ms. Nusheen Hashemi, the Open Society Foundations, of, where Mr. Anthony Richter and Ms. Fanush Hashemian helped us. I would also like to recognize the former chairman of the Woodrow Wilson Center, Ambassador Joe and Alma Gildenhorn, for their work supporting the Middle East Forum's Gildenhorn Forum. And I thought the ambassador, we were hoping that the ambassador from the Czech Republic would be here. I don't think he is here. Maybe he'll come a little bit late. Also, I would like to recognize the current Wilson Center Council members, Jan Smith and Michael Waller, and the chair of the Wilson Council, Diana Negroponte. Here, I would also like to thank my two colleagues, Kendra Heidemann and Julia Romano, without whom this event would not have happened. They put it together and they made it look effortless. All right, we are thrilled to have so many of you join us today, and we look forward to continuing the important work of the forum after today's event. Now, please join me in welcoming to the podium Jane Harman, who will introduce Secretary Albright.
How cool it is to have a box.
Yeah.
I've grown in this job. Yeah. And thank you, Henri, and thank you for your leadership at the Middle East program. We value it and we value you. How special to have two icons who happen to be women. An overflow crowd is here. In case you missed it, you're the lucky ones. You're in the room, but there are lots of you out there. Welcome to those two. Shawl is here. Hala's wonderful shawl is here. Joe and Alma are here. Joe and Alma are always here. The Barkeys, Ellen Lapson, are here. Rock star Robin Wright is right over there. She took 5 minutes off from work to be here. And many others that we love, like Tara and her family. But the big get today is our keynote, former Wilson Center scholar, Madeleine Albright. I knew Madeleine before the Wilson Center did. We carpooled to the Senate in the early 70s when each of us worked for a senator. Hers went on to be Secretary of State, mine lost re-election. We worked together in the Carter White House. She went on to become Dr. Albright, and wrote her book on dissident journalists involved in Poland's solidarity at the Wilson Center. She headed a think tank in the 80s called the Center for National Policy. I was one of its vice chairs, and I recall a drink we had, drinking was fun back in the day, in 1991, as I was running for Congress for the first time. Of course, Madeleine was my supporter and hosted an event, and she was in play for a series of significant jobs in the future administration. The really cool thing about Madeleine is she got the big jobs, and she still gets more big jobs, and yet she has never forgotten how her story can help other women and girls to strive and succeed. She and Haleh are the real deal. Brilliant, brave, always in the action. What an honor to share a Wilson platform with a pal, a staunch Wilson Center supporter, and we need all of you here to be Wilson Center supporters, and the most active woman I know. Just hear this. Chair of the Albright Stonebridge Group, chair of the National Democratic Institute, president of the Truman Scholarship Foundation, professor at the Georgetown School of Foreign Service, an Aspen Institute trustee, and recipient soon of the CIA Officers Memorial Foundation Helms Award. And it's probably 28 other things I don't know about. So please welcome former Wilson Center scholar, Madeleine Albright.
Great, Jane, that's so nice.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Jane. And it's obviously, there's nothing better than to be introduced by a really good friend. And Jane, we really have done an awful lot of things together, and all of them are fun, and they go on, and you have been a remarkable public servant. So thank you very much for inviting me and for being able to do this. And Henri, we have known each other for a long time, and thank you so much for making me a part of this incredible celebration and the inaugural Haleh Esfandiari Forum. I think, Haleh, terrific. And I'm always delighted to return to the Wilson Center. And I really do recall my time as a Wilson Fellow. There was a lot to like about the experience. I had the opportunity to do independent research, to meet scholars from all over the world, and I got paid to work in the Smithsonian Castle, which dates me quite a bit, in a town full of memorials. What sets the Wilson Center apart is that it is, in fact, a living monument. It memorializes not only Wilson, but Wilson's lifelong effort as an educator and as a president to map a trail for the future that would elude the traps of the past. I'm sorry the Czech ambassador isn't here, because the great link is between Czechoslovakia and Woodrow Wilson, or as we call him there, Woodrow Wilson. Really, that relationship between him and the first president of Czechoslovakia, Thomas Masaryk, was something that was so important. And the Czechoslovak constitution is modeled on the American one, except that in 1918, it actually had women's rights in it. And Woodrow Wilson, very apt for this particular session, was somebody who got married in the last quarter of the 19th century. He married an American, and he took her maiden name as his middle name. Her name was Charlotte Gehrig, and he was Thomas Gehrig Masaryk. So it's very apt that we're doing this here. The Wilson Center is a place where scholarly independence is prized and open dialogue is practiced, and it's also a place that is unafraid to shed light on tough issues. And that's especially true when it comes to the issue of women's empowerment in the Middle East. And the Wilson Center's important role in that field has everything to do with the woman that we're honoring today, Haleh. As the founding director of the Center's Middle East program and as a lifelong advocate for women and girls, Haleh has been a force for change and a resource for those committed to change. And like many of the women she has studied, Haleh has drawn the ire of authoritarians. I still recall that anguish we all felt when she was unjustly imprisoned and our relief that she was able to persevere through her release. Haleh's bravery in defying and defeating repression gives hope to all who cherish liberty and who believe in a better future for the women in the Middle East and North Africa. So I want to commend the Wilson Center for establishing this forum in Haleh's name and for committing resources to promote the public discussion of women's empowerment in the MENA region. Especially at this moment in history, I can't think of a topic more vital, nor of a region more in need of increased political and economic participation by women. And this is especially true because the world today seems full of self-proclaimed experts who consider women's rights to be a marginal concern when compared to the so-called hard issues of big power politics and the military. They simply don't get that the quality of women's lives has something very basic to do with the safety of our citizens and the overriding issues of war and peace. Even when I was in office, there was an obvious piece of evidence in support of that proposition, Afghanistan. What happened there with the Taliban is proof that the mistreatment of women is not a side issue. It's a symptom of the whole issue. Because those who abuse the dignity of some people endanger the security of all. And those who care about their own security had better stand up for the rights of women and girls. Of course, the problem of gender discrimination is not limited to Afghanistan, and it's a problem that is felt acutely across the Middle East and North Africa, where women have the lowest labor force participation rate and the lowest rate of political representation in the world. And this matters because we have learned that when women have the power to make our own economic and social choices, the chains of poverty can be broken, families are strengthened, and whole societies are more likely to be prosperous and at peace. Looking at the Middle East today, we see neither widespread peace nor broadly shared prosperity, but a toxic brew of challenges that is affecting the entire globe and America's own vital interests. More than 15 years after 9/11, Americans are clearly not in the mood to embark on an ambitious new effort in the region. Yet walking away from the Middle East is not a viable option. What is needed is a durable strategy for the region that reflects the world as it is today. For the past 2 years, I have co-chaired an Atlantic Council task force with former National Security Advisor Stephen Hadley, aimed at developing such an approach. In undertaking this effort, Steve and I deliberately sought to step back from the cycle of fire drills and band-aids and crisis response that dominates the discussion in Washington. We wanted to take a deeper look at what was happening and listen to voices from the region. So we traveled there extensively and sought perspectives from all levels of society, from refugees and students to business leaders and monarchs. What we found was that many positive things are happening in the Middle East, despite the dire headlines. Across the region, civic activists are working to make their local communities stronger and more resilient. Entrepreneurs are building small and medium-sized businesses, rather than relying on the government to provide employment. And some leaders are beginning to recognize that the region's greatest resource is not its oil, but its people. In other words, there is something to work with. There are green shoots of progress that need our support and countries that need our sustained engagement. And to that end, we proposed a two-pronged strategy in our task force. And while the first prong involves using military and diplomatic tools to wind down the civil wars and get political settlements, it is the second prong that we believe holds the key to long-term stability for the region. The second prong focuses on supporting bottoms-up efforts of social activists and civic entrepreneurs and on encouraging governments to invest in the education and empowerment of their people. We believe that this is the only way to address the societal, economic, and governance issues that are key to future peace and success. Ultimately, our strategy seeks to unlock the significant human potential in the Middle East and one of the region's most undervalued and underdeveloped resources is its women. In making this recommendation, we were sensitive to the idea that some in the Middle East might see this as an attempt to impose Western values on the region. When I visited Saudi Arabia last year, I obviously met with a group of women, many of whom had high positions or were members of their parliament. And they actually said that in some cases it was counterproductive for Westerners to constantly keep focusing on the issues. It was a reminder that we shouldn't simply expect women in the Middle East to be our mirror images. And I hope we talk about that more, because we have that tendency to think that everybody wants to do things exactly the way we do. They actually have other interests than driving. At the same time, there are some principles that cross every border of nation and culture, and namely that women are entitled to have our voices heard, and the contributions of women are essential to the success of any country. So we need to find the right way to stress the importance of women's empowerment in the region, and that's why the work of the Wilson Center Middle East Program and the Global Women's Leadership Initiative is so important. There are 100 different ways in which women with power can contribute to their societies. And perhaps that's why those who view women's empowerment as a threat will resort to anything, including violence, to stop it. Which brings me to something that is too often overlooked in discussions of women's empowerment. And that is the alarming but uncounted number of women who are specifically targeted because they are engaged in political activity, whether voting, running for office, or simply expressing their political views. This type of violence is not limited to that which makes headlines. It can be threats made in the home, as in the case of one Tunisian woman whose fiancé told her he would end their relationship if she continued to run for office. It can be threats made in cyberspace, as in the case of countless politically active women who are subjected to online harassment. I've been determined to call attention to this problem, and that's why on International Women's Day last year, I helped the National Democratic Institute launch a global campaign to stop violence against women in politics. In the months since the campaign's launch, NDI has been collecting incident reports, including in Arabic, to help establish better data and raise global awareness. It has also developed a detailed program guidance so that people working in the field can incorporate the issues into their training. And all this matters because no country can build a healthy, growing economy or establish trust in government if half its people are held back, pushed aside, left behind, or beaten up. From Tunisia to Syria, women have played a significant role in organizing opposition to autocratic regimes. If the promise of political openness is ever to become a reality, they must be allowed a prominent voice in new governing structures. Still, I'm concerned that chauvinistic habits die hard. Many men in the region are undoubtedly sincere in their desire to protect women from the rough and tumble of politics. But they should understand that the way to protect women in the Middle East is not to patronize them, but to allow them to exercise their rights. Historically, it has fallen on the United States government to make the case for empowering women, not because it makes us popular, but because it is so clearly in our interest and consistent with our values. Yet today, it's unclear how hard the new administration will fight for women's rights. The budget cuts they have proposed, including to the Wilson Center, would directly reduce our influence and effectiveness in dealing with these issues, but at least we won't be forcing men to many senators to worry about mammograms. The truth is that foreign assistance is among the most efficient and valuable tools we have. In the long run, nothing is more expensive than poverty, suffering, and war. So I sincerely hope that Congress rejects these unwise cuts, protects programs for women's empowerment around the world. We seem to be living in a moment when hard power is all that can grab the attention of the administration. But we should remember that the women's movement has endured and prospered not because it's trendy, but because of the underlying power of its central premise, which is that every individual counts. The basic idea of valuing each person fairly is what has united women's movements across the boundaries of geography, ethnicity, vocation, and generation. It's what gives us faith that the day will come when every girl everywhere will be able to look ahead with confidence, that her life will be cherished, her individuality respected, her rights protected, and her future determined solely by her own ability and character. The philosophy is not based on any illusions. Advocates of social progress have seen far too much of the hardship and frustration to indulge in sentimentalism. But we live in a nation and in a world that has been enriched beyond measure by those who have overcome enormous obstacles to build platforms of knowledge and accomplishment from which others might advance. More than two decades ago, I was honored to lead the U.S. delegation to the Beijing Women's Conference. And in the run-up to that event, I came upon a poem that reflected an old folk tradition. In the poem, a father says to his young daughter, "We keep a dog to watch the house. A pig is useful too. We keep a cat to catch a mouse. But what can we do with a girl like you?" Across the Middle East today, millions of women have answered that question in a way that cannot be denied. Through their accomplishments, they have demonstrated that, and given the opportunity, there is nothing, and I mean nothing, women cannot do. Today, our goal must be to see that opportunity exists for every girl and every woman everywhere. And that's a big job and a big commitment. But it is a commitment that must be made by America and all those around the world who share our hope for the future more democratic and prosperous than the past. So in closing, I would really like to thank Haleh and the Wilson Center and Jane, really, for what you have done to try to achieve this goal. And I congratulate you and salute you, and I now really look forward to having a discussion and answering your questions, which I will be able to do since I'm no longer in the government.
You can keep applauding, it's okay, it's okay. She deserves it. So I brought a prop, Madeleine, which I'm going to show off, and you will recognize it. It is the proverb that Madeleine talked about, and it says, "To Jane Harman, many thanks for your support of Beijing. All best, Madeleine, 1995. I was there, too. It was a tiny little congressional delegation of four, three women and a man. Chris Smith is the man, and he really does support human rights. He may not support our own list of issues for women's rights, but he does support human rights. At any rate, I just wanted to ask you about that iconic moment when Hillary Clinton and you entered this room, that, in case some of you weren't born yet, this whole conference was staged in the mud in the suburbs of Beijing. I think they were terrified that these uppity women would take over. Which we did, but it was in the mud and way far out, and getting there was a project, maybe not if you were First Lady or Secretary of State. Were you Secretary of State by then?
No, you're still UN ambassador.
UN ambassador. But anyway, at any rate, we're all there, and Hillary and Madeleine enter the room, which is electric in its own right, and then Hillary uttered the most iconic words ever said to women anywhere, and everyone remembers them. Do we remember them? Human rights are women's rights, and women's rights are human rights. So how did that happen? What's the...
Well, I think what is interesting was, obviously, there was the issue about having this women's conference at all, and then the decision had been made by the previous administration, by H.W. Bush, that it should be in Beijing, because there really were questions as to why were we doing this in Beijing. And we decided that we needed to go ahead with doing it in Beijing, and then kind of trying to put together the delegation and trying to figure out what our message was. And by the way, they truly were terrified of us. And among the things that they did was to give sheets to all the cab drivers to throw over the naked women that they were expecting. And then I kept being asked by people, "Where is this country of lesbia?" since all the lesbians were coming. And so it was one thing after another. And then we were told that we could not, you could see that the mirrors were, they were watching us in our rooms. And we were also told we couldn't iron for some reason. Anyway, I was ironing and all of a sudden you're on television ironing. So the whole thing was very strange. The truth is that I'm often asked about life balance questions. I actually left my youngest daughter's wedding reception in order to go with Hillary to Beijing. So that was kind of one of those classic choices. We went together, and those were Hillary's words. That is what she wanted to say. And she really decided as we were flying over that that was her message. And the thing that was so interesting was it was the normal kind of buzz of conferences, and then when Hillary spoke, the whole kind of, it just, you could feel it electrically through the whole hall. And it really has become the kind of a motto of the women's movement. And it was really fantastic. So, and then I have to say, she went back and I went to do something else, which also sticks in my memory, which was to fly to Burma to meet Aung San Suu Kyi, a remarkable woman. So,
not too shabby for one trip. So my second prop is something you're also wearing. Many of you have these. There, it says 50 by 50, and it relates to something Henri mentioned, which is a project of our Global Women's Leadership Institute headed by Gwen Young called the Partnership for Public Service. And it was founded by the Seven Sister Women's Colleges. There are only five of those that are all women left. And Secretary of State Hillary Clinton and others some years back, and it migrated from the State Department to the Wilson Center. And we have been building it, and we have focused on developing a worldwide index of women's participation in public service, significant roles in public service. So I know you know about this project, and you love this project. Will we have an impact on this?
Well, I think we will, because I really do believe that it is something that has to be constantly front and center. And talking about the fact about having women in roles that have influence, I think one of the questions is, what are all the roles? You know, is it being in the government, or is it being heads of institutions, NGOs, doing things in the business sector? And I think the thing that this is very broad-based in terms of women's influence and power is something that can be all over. And I think it's very important to have a dedicated approach to it and then be consistent and keep kind of spreading it. So I definitely hope so. And Haleh, it's just terrific, I think, really. And very much, it's not just in the Middle East, it's everywhere.
No, it's worldwide.
And it would help in the United States, too.
Yeah, we're not ahead, in case anyone missed it. I think Rwanda, Gwen, am I right, it has 63%?
Yep.
64, it's going up. And Canada now has 50% of its cabinet positions filled by women. And the United States has about 20% in our federal legislature. But we have never had a woman president. Did anyone notice that? Our goal is, in case I missed saying this, 50% women by 2050.
Yeah. Which is not crazy. Given the fact that more than every country's more than half of the population is women. And the bottom line is for no other reason, it's a wasted resource if you don't have women involved.
So. Well, we're over 50% of the talent pool. Think about it that way. Why shouldn't we participate on that basis? I mentioned that you and I were in a carpool going to the Senate back in the day, way back in the day, in another century. And, you know, it's interesting, since it's all over the news, to reflect on how much Congress has changed. Just would welcome your insights.
Well, first of all, I loved working there. I worked for Ed Muskie, who was really a remarkable senator, one of the kinds of people that you called a giant or a whale or somebody that, and he loved being there. And what was interesting was the bipartisanship. He was, and it's very germane at the moment, because he was the first chairman of the Budget Committee. The budget process had just begun, was just put in place, and he's the one that kind of, and the staff developed how it would run. And the first thing he said to us was, you are going to go and work with Henry Bellman, the ranking member from Oklahoma, a Republican, and we spent a lot of time doing bipartisan things, and it worked in so many different ways. And I think many lessons from it. First of all, I do think that I'm hoping that people in Congress themselves and the American public not only have read the Constitution, but understand that Article 1 is the power of Congress, and that the special aspect of the U.S. government is that executive-legislative relationship. But it takes two sides to play it. And I do think that some in Congress have forgotten that, and the role that Congress really can play, and certainly the administration kind of thinks it up at the last minute. So, but I do think that what is different, Jane, is the not just the civility, but the friendship of the people that worked in Congress. And some of it has to do with the fact that they actually lived here, and that their families got to know each other and aspects. But it also was kind of realizing there's no way to describe what it was like to work for Ed Muskie, because he understood the responsibility of representing not only the people of Maine, but also the American people. And there was just a sense of great love of being a public servant, and it was great to work for him.
Well, I totally agree with that. And a lot of the Wilson senior staff is in the audience, and I see Mike Van Dusen over there. Hi, Mike. Yeah, welcome back. But, you know, Lee Hamilton was another of the
very
giants,
much.
Just to make a point. And there were Republican giants like Jack Javits and others who worked across the aisle. And when I got there, it was during the Nixon impeachment. I didn't have a role on any of the committees that were doing that. But the government functioned. What was interesting was the impeachment vote in the House was bipartisan. Just it's impossible to imagine this. Nixon then resigned. The transition to Ford was difficult because Ford pardoned Nixon. That was very controversial. The government kept working, and the Congress was bipartisan. People did live here, and they worked together to solve problems. Now, instead, they work to blame each other for not solving problems. And I think it's a tragedy for our country. And if you think about just women and girls in the world, Congress can contribute a lot through the foreign aid budget and through a lot of other things. But it is, you know, pretty dysfunctional, and that is enormously disappointing.
The bipartisanship, let me just say that people will find this hard to believe, but one of the people that I worked with really well when I was in office was Jesse Helms. And it began in the following way. I was ambassador in New York, and I'd actually gotten invited by a women's college in Raleigh for their bicentennial. And they had invited me to speak, and he was calling to follow up. And I have to admit, frankly, that I was trying to figure out how to get out of it. And so I said, well, Mr. Chairman, I'm happy to go if you go with me. And he said, well, that's interesting. So he calls me back, and he says, I just changed my schedule, and I will go with you. And so what happens is that when somebody introduces you, they don't usually say this woman is hopeless and an idiot. So he couldn't have been nicer. And then what he said, this worked so well as we were coming home. He said, I want you to come to my alma mater, Wingate. So I went there. He picks me up in Raleigh. We're driving around North Carolina looking for barbecue places. And by the time we get there, he had had an artificial hip, and so he was stiff, and I'm helping it out of the car. And there's this photograph of me hanging on to him, and the press says, the odd couple. And then when I was named to be secretary, he said, Ms. Madeleine, we will make history together. And it made all the difference that we had that kind of friendship and relationship.
Super story. Yeah. And happens so rare, too rarely. And a great tribute to you, Madeleine, because you reached for people like him. And that's how the Congress used to work, and sadly doesn't. My final question is, and you mentioned this, violence against women, rape and sexual assault as a tool of war. Helene Cooper was here last week, another former Wilson scholar. She has written a fabulous biography of Ellen Johnson Sirleaf, who was the first elected leader of an African country, Liberia. And Helene is also from Liberia. Yeah. And their early stories are somewhat similar. But Johnson Sirleaf, the story of her early life is horrifying. The amount of abuse, including by her husband, and the fact that that's routine, or certainly was routine in Liberia. And there's one story where she's imprisoned and she thinks she's going to be raped. This is Sirleaf we're talking about, described in the book. And someone saves her. But rape is a kind of a casual event against women. And the one thing that isn't casual is killing women. They almost killed her. And this was not consistent with the culture. So she was, I guess, lucky she didn't get killed or raped, and then she became leader of the country, because the market women, who are the sort of ground troops in the country, who sell oranges on the street, united to support her. But my comment is, again, about something you mentioned, just to ask you for any more insights about what this audience, Congress, this administration can do. Rape, sexual abuse, violence against women as an ongoing constant in the culture of so many countries. Yeah.
Let me back up a little bit on this because of the following thing, and it has to do with, I think that it's important to get a critical mass of women working on a variety of issues. So what happened when I got to the UN, it was one of the first times I didn't have to cook lunch myself. So there were 183 members of the UN at the time. And so I asked my assistant to invite the other women permanent representatives so that I could get to know them. So I get to my apartment, and there's six other women out of Bali, from Canada, Kazakhstan, Philippines, Trinidad, Tobago, Jamaica, and Liechtenstein. Since I was the American, I had to form a caucus. And we called ourselves the G7. And what we did, and it goes to the point that you asked, we decided out of our great power that we would lobby. We had just, the War Crimes Tribunal for the former Yugoslavia had just been set up, and that it needed to have women judges, some, because most of the crimes were against women, and it was rape. And so we did manage to get two women judges on that War Crimes Tribunal, and then ultimately rape was declared a weapon of war. And so even a small number, if we do things together, and by the way, we promised always to take each other's telephone calls, and people would say, why are you talking to Liechtenstein and some man? And I would say, well, if you have yourself replaced by a woman, I will always take your phone call. So, but I do think that the issue here now is that it does take concerted action, and there's so many things that are going on as we speak in this country. There's stories in the paper today about a man that taught at Annapolis, and then people did not want him speaking because he had been terrible about not having women in combat, a number of different things. Mm-hmm. So these are not old issues. Yeah. And certainly in terms of violence in this country and also generally disrespect. But I do think that what is a terrible problem in the with the peacekeepers and issues that are taking place in terms of violence against women still in where the peacekeeping operations are, and then, frankly, in so many other places. And some of it, as I mentioned in my remarks, is not physical beating, but threats and trying to keep women out of the system.
Right. Okay, your questions? Please raise your hand, identify yourself, and ask a question, not a long comment. Please, in the back, in the red sweater.
Hi, I'm Joanna Brignolo. Madam Secretary, it's an honor to be here with you. I'm looking to the future. I hope you don't take the query incorrectly or anyways, but it would be, I think, a great boon if you would consider running for president and ask Hillary to be your VP, and we'd have a powerhouse ticket.
First of all, thank you for saying that. Second, I wasn't born in this country, which is not the only reason that I couldn't be president. But I do think that it would be, I find very hard to believe that it was so hard to elect a woman president who is clearly more qualified. And I think part of the issue that I have is I don't quite understand why people are so afraid of having a woman president. And we, as Jane said, we are not first. There are other countries that have women presidents. And we are always so proud to be number one in everything. And I just find it very weird, frankly, that it can't happen. I do think that what is very important is that we need to develop a pipeline of women that are qualified to be president. And so having women in Congress, having women governors, having women kind of move up the steps, there need to be more women that are available. Now, the truth is that I wouldn't support every woman to be president. I would prefer a man that understands what the issues are, But I do think that we need to figure out how to have more women in the system so that we have choices. I also, frankly, don't believe that the world would be better off if it were only run by women, because if you think that, you've forgotten high school.
I would just point out, though, that Madeleine could run for senator or Congress.
That I could do, yes.
She could do that, young person that she is. Yeah. Let me ask a question from the overflow room, and then we'll go to Bob Dickey. All good questions, and remember, there are a lot of people sitting outside this room who wish they were right here. A lot of them. What suggestions do you have to increase economic opportunities for women, especially in Tunisia, where the issue of 30% unemployment among youth is critical in addressing the greater issues of security? Period. And I assume that applies to, economic opportunities for women and unemployment in a high unemployment place.
I think that it's not just Tunisia, but in the study that we were doing on the Middle East and North Africa, part of the problem has been is that the government has been the employer of first resort. And so that has changed. And so then the question is, where are the jobs and how do they get created? And I think that one of the things actually that happened was, as you all probably remember, President Obama gave a speech about having a different relationship with Muslim majority countries. And Secretary Clinton wanted to expand on that, so she asked me to run something called Partners for a New Beginning, which were public-private partnerships in Muslim majority countries. And Tunisia is one of the countries that we worked in. And part of the thing was really getting it into the system that if you want people that will work hard, that will be those that really move forward through the system, I think that you have to keep asking, and the investors, the private sector companies, have to kind of make that insistence. And so Tunisia is a very good example now of the developing civil society,
right.
And that's a very important part, and also education, and it's partially this movement up.
And it's a lot of help from the National Democratic Institute and the International Republican Institute,
right.
NDI and IRI, right. Which were there. I was part of it.
Right.
As
well, we went together.
Observing mission. Yeah. Madeleine heads NDI, and it builds it monitors elections, but it also builds political capacity.
I think the thing that's important to think about, the Arab Spring began in Tunisia, and part of it was that this vegetable vendor. His father had died, and his mother, because of the laws, was not able to inherit the land, etc. And so he didn't have money. Now, it would be a great women's story, except that what happened, he was disrespected by a police official who happened to have been a woman, and that made it even worse. But I do think that there are issues within the system that need to be dealt with to make sure that women have equal opportunity in countries in terms of the laws.
Bob Dickey.
Yes, thank you. Oh, thank you very much. I'm Bob Dickey from Boston and a friend of the center's. Madam Secretary, that was a terrific set of comments. Thank you very much. They were illuminating and appreciated. Can you all hear me?
Yeah. Put the mic right next to you.
That good? That better?
That's better.
Okay, good. I was saying thank you.
Madam Secretary. We heard that.
Early in your remarks, you noted that there's a correlation, at least, if not a causal effect, between women's rights and women's education on the one hand and national prosperity on the other. And instinctively, that sounds right. And further, a bit later in your remarks, you suggested that there may be a causal, at least a correlative effect between a relationship between prosperity and peace. Do we know of any studies? I mean, it's really a question, not just for you, but for all of us, that really take a hard look at that, because it'd be compelling to those who might not agree with us.
I think there are, in terms of provided by USAID and a number of non-governmental organizations. I think the thing that is very interesting and kind of proof of the pudding is that let's take microloans, for instance, that when they are given to women, they are paid back. And that having women have jobs that allow them to work with their families kind of that are tailored to things that women can do where they can. And also that we do know that societies where women are economically and politically empowered are more stable. I actually was the first person to put women's issues central to American foreign policy. Hillary took it to a whole different level. But the reason I did it, not just because I'm a feminist, but because we could see that societies were more stable when that happened. And so I think that there is a correlation, definitely.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah. Jan.
Madam Secretary, what women leaders around the world...
Jan Smith.
Thank you, Jan Smith. what women leaders around the world do you most admire and why?
Well, different ones for different reasons, you know. I have to say that I admire Angela Merkel because she is steady. And by the way, what was so interesting, I met her originally when she had just taken over the party from Kohl, and she was actually kind of tentative in some ways. And then she became chancellor, and she came to the United States, and it was chancellor. And she really, I think we all treasure the idea that you can grow into a role. And I think she really did. She undergoes an awful lot of pressure from a variety of places, is not exactly welcomed as she should be in various places. And she is a leader in a non kind of bossy way. I think she's quite remarkable. I see her occasionally, and I think, but there are others. I mean, somebody that I've known for a long time that you know too that has gone through many iterations is Margot Wallström, who is now the Swedish foreign minister.
Right.
And she is somebody that worked on women's issues, and she did at the UN. Sweden is one of the countries that really does have a lot of women in their system. But she cares about women's issues in addition to her responsibilities as foreign minister. I wish there were more women to admire in various places. But I think that I admire those at all levels. And the bottom line is I met an awful lot of women in fancy rooms. But the ones that I really admire were the women in refugee camps that were able to live through horrible things, or in hospitals, or in various places, and who are working under the most difficult circumstances. I am a groupie, so what I did, I had the G7, and then what happened was when I was secretary, I created a group of women foreign ministers, the fearsome 14 at the time, but they're not enough, and part of it is having that support system, I think.
Yeah. Gwen Young.
Hi, I want to come back to your comment about women in leadership and the power piece of it. So what can we tell institutions or translation governments into increasing the power of women? Because you can hold the office, you can have the leadership role, you can have the budget, but how do you increase the power? So there's the part of the women themselves bringing the power, but what can institutions do to change that dynamic?
Well, I think that that's a very hard question because one can have designs of institutions, but if you don't have the kind of mass collective support, they can be changed in a number of different ways. But I think that part of it is to give power to, this is the issue. If you give power to an institution and it's run by an autocrat, it doesn't do you any good, Turkey. And so the question is, how do you establish a system that gives power that can be used properly? And that's the worrisome part. Because if you say you want a presidential system and then they decide they're going to do it differently. So I think that the institutional part is difficult. Therefore, it's a matter, I think, of developing the people that then will either limit the power if it's necessary or be able to expand it depending upon who the person is. But I get back to the point is there has to be a stepping stone. I think the hardest part is actually to be a woman and kind of parachute in at the top, because then there are questions about legitimacy that may not come up for a man. And therefore, if you've worked up the system, so a number of different institutions that lead to the highest power.
And we're collecting, as part of the Women in Public Service Project, stories, are we not, Gwen, of women leaders, and some of the stories should be very helpful to women trying to exercise power well. Another overflow question, then we'll go to the middle of the room, but it reminds me that one of our scholars, I think she is still here, she's not here in the room, but is former Malawi President Joyce Banda,
who's
enormously impressive. And she speaks to she says that the key to empowering women leaders is reaching for them we talk about women and girls, but she talks about adolescents. And that's this question, too. It says, what about young women? How can we ensure our efforts are inclusive to young women?
I think that this goes with what is a key aspect of everything, which is education, and trying to figure out, and it goes to the institutional aspect in terms of making sure that they have the education, and then, in fact, making them understand that they can be whoever they want to be. That is the issue of giving that kind of confidence and not kind of saying, you know, the boy sitting next to you can do it, but you can't. And I think that it's a question of mentoring, I think is the best way to put it, and trying to figure out how you make a young woman feel that she can do something.
I totally agree, just thinking about my own career, and I found mentors. And I gained confidence by going to a women's college, which you also did.
Yeah.
And it was enormously helpful. Okay, let's see. Let's go in the back of the room. There's a woman, third row. Yes, you.
Hi, my name's Haley Lepp, Secretary Albright. I'm a former student of yours at Georgetown.
That means you're well-educated.
I have a question that builds off the last question. In the political sphere in the U.S. and worldwide, especially in the MENA region, the conversation about women in power tends to be dominated by rich and mostly white, mostly European language-speaking women. How can this conversation make a space for, especially in the Middle East, women of the region to express their power in the global narrative and especially in education?
I think, by the way, I just would like to make a flat-out admission in terms of my own misunderstanding about how to deal with women in the Middle East. And I'm going to give you two examples of this. One is that when I had been invited to a conference in Riyadh, and it was a huge room, and I was speaking and I said something about women's rights and issues, and there was a lot of applause, and the people sitting in front of me were not applauding. And what I then figured out was that the women were on a curtain to the side, that I couldn't see them at all. And so then what had happened was that at this conference, I had been, and I was, I had just come out of office, frankly, and I was invited to a dinner with various heads of state and ministers, and I was told that that's where I needed to go. And then I later learned that I had also been invited to dinner with the women. And I went to the one with the heads of state and ministers because I thought, well, that's who I was, and I should. And then some of the women came up to me and said, why didn't you have dinner with us? And I felt perfectly awful about it. I really did. The other thing was that I was actually in Turkey, and I was having a meeting with women, some of whom were covered and some of whom were not. And I was asked, how do you feel about that? Should women wear the hijab? Should they? And I said, well, the word that I always have for women is choice, and you should be able to decide. And then one of the women came up to me and she said, why did you do that? You should tell us which one you believe is right. And so I didn't do that right. And so the other part, I was telling the story about when we were meeting with these women from Saudi Arabia, and when they actually said to me, you know, why don't you people leave us alone and not tell us all the time? That's the mirror imaging part of it. So I'm not sure we've got this right. That's part of the issue. And I think that we need help from women, which is why I think this program is important, of trying to figure out and not to do mirror imaging, as I mentioned in my remarks. And then I have to tell the story because there were questions as to whether a woman could, when my name came up to be Secretary of State, it was said that a woman could not be Secretary of State because Arab leaders would not deal with a woman. So what happened was that the Arab ambassadors at the UN got together and put out a statement, and they said, we had no problems dealing with Ambassador Albright. We wouldn't have any problems dealing with Secretary Albright. So that then went away. And then what happened, somebody at the White House, I never want to know who, said, yeah, Madeleine's on the list, but she's second tier. Anyway, I did become Secretary of State. And my first, one of my first meetings was with the Gulf Cooperation Council ministers. And we were a great meeting, and I said to them in the end, thank you very much, you've been so kind, and perhaps you haven't noticed that I'm dressed differently from my predecessors, and next time we'll talk about women's rights. And we did, because they had daughters and they were interested in talking about it. But the only time that I regretted, that I really felt that it made a difference that I was not a man, was when King Hussein of Jordan died. And he and Queen Noor were really good friends. And I was told that if I couldn't march in the cortege because I was a woman and I needed to go sit with the spouses. And I thought, even though Queen Noor and I were friends, I didn't think that was right for the Secretary of State of the U.S. And I didn't go, and I'm really sorry, because he was a friend. And so there were kind of issues. But I think that we have to talk to the women in the region a little bit more than kind of saying, this is the way it needs to be done.
Yeah. Well, there's too many questions, I'm sorry, but in the middle with the glasses, and then I'm warning Haleh that whether she likes it or not, I'm sitting up here,
yeah.
That we would love you to make a comment or ask a question to conclude.
Thank you. My name is Ryan Kelleher. Madeleine Albright, it's an honor to be in the room with you. As somebody who is studying U.S. foreign policy and somebody who wants to get involved in U.S. diplomacy, it's wonderful to hear from you. And somebody who has a younger sister, again, it does strike a little bit of a personal chord for me. You've always been quoted saying that the United States is seen as the indispensable nation, in the sense that we're the ones who are first to uphold values, liberty, and freedom across the world. So my question is, as somebody who has a younger sister and somebody who would like to get involved in the Foreign Service and continue into U.S. diplomacy, what recommendations would you make to my generation as we become the next leaders who fill the government positions in the United States? Thank you.
Well, thank you very much for asking that, because one of the I do teach. And I teach a course, I say foreign policy is just trying to get some country to do what you want. So what are the tools? And my course is called the National Security Toolbox. And it requires an understanding of how decision making works, how the tools work, how do the tools get enacted, which goes back to one of the issues about the role of Congress, and generally understanding how the system works. I think, however, that one of the things that's happening at the moment is that we are operating in a completely different world system. And I am testified, I had this in my testimony last week, and I'm going to repeat it, that institutions and humans at 70 actually need a little refurbishing. And basically, what has happened is that your generation has to look at things a bit differently. And I'm teaching now, and I'm learning from my students in many ways, because social media, we did our role play over the weekend, you'll remember that, is that there is a completely different approach about information all of a sudden, in terms of how it's absorbed, what's true, not just what's true, but the rapidity of it, how institutions work generally. I do know that what is absolutely essential is for people to want to do foreign policy. That it really is the way that our country, every country, explains itself to another. And it requires people who are endlessly interested, not only in their own country, but most of all interested in other countries, and put themselves into the other country's shoes. Because the only way to do diplomacy is to understand what the other people need. And so it's actually international relations is a growth industry at the moment. And what it requires that's very different. When I went to college, which was sometime between the invention of the iPad and the discovery of fire, it was a really big deal that I took poli-sci and history and then econ. Now, I think that what your generation needs to do is to understand the breadth, the interdisciplinary aspect of it, to understand science, and to actually, I wrote a book in which I thought that our diplomats needed to understand the religious background of countries and to understand, and the indispensable nation business is an exceptional, the U.S. is but nothing in the definition of that says alone. And so it's building partnerships and understanding common threads that are necessary. But I do hope that those of you that are young see that the United States and our safety depends on what we call soft power, diplomats, an understanding and the role of men and women in terms of talking about value system. We cannot impose democracy, that's an oxymoron, but we can in fact understand that we're all the same and people want to participate in decisions in their own life and they need the tools to do that.
Haleh.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Madam Secretary. I've been an admirer of yours. It's an honor to have you here. And you're a role model for all of us, not only in this country, but around the world. Thank you, Jane, for your support from day one at the center when you hugged me on the fifth floor. And then you have been supporting the Middle East program. Henri, my thanks to you. And Kendra and Julia, wherever they are, my friends, they made it possible. Madam Secretary, I have been in this business of women's issues for 50 years. I started 50 years ago in Iran, working on the personal status law, which is crucial in my part of the world. And it was an uphill battle, but we made it. What I'm worried now is that my region is torn apart because of terrorism, because of civil war or wars, and also because of the flood of men and women and children refugees. I want to keep this hope. You know, I cannot live without hope for a better future. But when I look ahead of me, I don't see a bright future. That's one of my concerns. The other concern is that a lot of people look to the United States as a country that would always open its arms to people from the outside. And they hope to come here for a better life and a better future. And my sense is that if we continue opening the door to them, they will live up to the standard that previous generation, like myself, have lived up to the standard of this country. What can be done for them?
Well, first of all, thank you really for everything that you've done. I mean, you have devoted your life and taken on such responsibilities. We all really admire you, and we really all did suffer when you were incarcerated. And I mean, you have so many, so thanks to you, really. Let me just say that this goes back to what kind of a country we're. I'm a refugee. My father was a Czechoslovak diplomat, and we spent the war in England, all through the Blitz, and then he went back to Czechoslovakia. He was made ambassador to Yugoslavia, and then his next assignment. And then he didn't want to work for the communists, so. When he got to the United States, we didn't have any terrible story of crawling through barbed wire. We came on diplomatic passports, but he defected. And he used to say on a regular basis, when we were in England, people would say, "We're so sorry, your country's been taken over by a terrible dictator. You're welcome here. What can we do to help you, and when are you going home?" When we came to the United States, people would say, "We're so sorry, your country's been taken over by a terrible system. You're welcome here. What can we do to help you, and when will you become a citizen?" And he said, that is what made America different from every other country. Mm-hmm. And I have renewed my vows. I became a citizen when I was in college. Nothing gives me more pleasure than to participate in naturalization ceremonies. Mm-hmm. And my favorite one, I have to say, was on July 4th during 2000, the millennium, at Monticello. And all of a sudden, I was giving people their naturalization certificates, and I heard this man saying, can you imagine that I just got my naturalization certificate from the Secretary of State, and I'm a refugee? And I said, can you imagine that a refugee is Secretary of State? And so that is something about America. So I am very, very troubled by what is going on now. And I'm troubled by the whole refugee issue, and have spent quite a lot of time on it, and I've been to the refugee camps, and I have participated in a number of different elements trying to get something done. I am appalled by what is happening here. We cannot tell other countries to take more refugees if we are not doing the same. I spent a lot of time this fall driving across America. We are a very large country. We have plenty of room. And I think that we are exceptional, and the Statue of Liberty does have language on it that says that we welcome people. So I'm stunned. I and a bunch of other former officials, I think the ban is outrageous. I think it makes things only worse. And you look at what's happening in Canada, for instance, where they are open arms and generous, and I think that this is something, it's un-American. There's only a way to describe it. And I do think that refugees have made a difference here. This is what this country is about. So I'm hoping that, and by the way, what I'm hoping now, and in case people haven't guessed what I think, is that we have to show the resilience of democracy. And the resilience of democracy is the free press, and also the elected officials. Where we started, Article 1 of the Constitution, and democracy, and the resilience of it. And I think that that's the message that has to emanate in terms of that America is exceptional, but we can't ask that exceptions be made for us in terms of the way that we treat people or that we are not part of this much larger issue. There haven't been this many refugees since World War II. And they live in ways, and the thing, if we don't want to do it because we're humanitarian, I bet many of you have visited refugee camps, they can't become the petri dish of people that will end up hating us, which is why there has to be ways to get them out, and then also, it's not an emergency anymore, it's what's going on. And so education, what we were talking about, has to take place in the refugee camps, and there has to be a system. So I do think it's the plague that is really, when we talk about new systems and things that have to be done, and it's very germane to this thing that Steve Hadley and I did in terms of kind of looking at the longer, deeper time for it.
So let's end on a hopeful note, and that is that people like Haleh and Madeleine did come to this country and have added so much to this country, and that the Middle East program here is vibrant and well, thanks to you, Haleh, and the people who followed you. And I think Henri is going to close the proceedings. I just want to say, personally, as another woman who was first to head this institution, how much we value Gwen Young and others here, I see many of you in the audience, who are making the point that women's empowerment is a way that a society like the United States can become a better country. So I'm not closing this. I'm sure Henri wants to say something finally.
No, I just want to say thank you for a wonderful event. Please join me in thanking Secretary Albright and Jane for such an lively for a great start to the Haleh Esfandiari Forum. You are all invited. You are all invited to a reception outside, but please give us a minute to escort Secretary Albright out, and then you're welcome for a wonderful reception. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, please remain seated. Please remain seated until she leaves. Thank you.
Not us.
Okay.
I'm just going to go around there.
This way. Okay.